Thank you all for coming here today. My name is Daniel Gluck, and I am the Executive Director and General Counsel of the Hawaii State Ethics Commission, and with me is Rachael Wong. Several months ago, the Commission received a complaint from Ms. Wong, former Director of the State Department of Human Services, alleging sexual harassment by then Speaker of the House, Joseph Souki. The staff of the Ethics Commission conducted a thorough and confidential investigation during which we received allegations from several women. On Friday, the Commission approved a settlement agreement with Speaker Emeritus Souki, the terms of which are described in the resolution of investigation document released today. Pursuant to the agreement, Speaker Emeritus Souki will resign from his position as a representative effective next Friday, March 30th. He will pay an administrative penalty of $5,000 to the State of Hawaii General Fund. He agrees not to seek or accept any public office for a period of 2 years, and he agrees to issue a public apology. There are more than 50,000 state officials who serve the people of Hawaii, and the overwhelming majority do so with the utmost integrity and professionalism every day. The Ethics Commission's mission is to ensure that public officials meet the highest ethics standards, and we will continue to do so. The Commission wants to offer its sincere thanks to Ms. Wong and to all the other individuals who cooperated with this investigation. And Ms. Wong would like to make a statement.
Thanks, Dan. Aloha and good afternoon, everybody. Thank you for coming. I'm going to read my statement, which is a little long, but I ask you to stay with me for the whole time. I'm speaking for myself, who has, you know, I've been in silence for quite a while, but also for many of the women who are not here today and cannot speak. This is a day of closure for me and for other women, and it also marks the beginning of a transformation that many have said is long overdue. The hundreds of messages I've received reinforce the need for positive, substantive change in Hawaii. They revolve around similar themes. Thank you for speaking for me, for my daughters, for giving voice. We've all been there, me too. I really want to tell my story. I don't know where I can go. The status quo is unacceptable. Our culture often prevents us from speaking out when there's injustice, and we're taught not to put others in shame because we live in a small community. These are some of the very reasons why people suffer in silence for years and why things stay the same. It's time for a new way of doing things in Hawaii, and I'm hopeful because of what's possible. This press conference was called because of resolution of an investigation. In fact, today represents much more for Hawaii. This can be a springboard. This can be a springboard for a different future for all of us. My motivation behind filing the complaint and publicly coming forward is that I deeply love Hawaii. We can and we must do better for each other and our future. I envision a state where anyone who has experienced sexual harassment in the workplace can safely come forward without fear of retribution, retaliation, or loss of reputation. The public shaming, vitriolic judgments, and hate mail I received since my complaint went public only further solidify my vision for a better Hawaii and hopefully explain why I was compelled to speak. It's time to end the misuse and abuse of position and authority in the public work in the workplace. First, I want to start with a few brief acknowledgments. I would like to thank the Hawaii State Ethics Commission for its thorough investigation of my complaint and the tremendous amount of work that went into this resolution. The Commission staff are consistently professional and responsive, and they honored our requests for confidentiality. This is from all of us who came forward throughout the process. I'm grateful that an entity like the Commission exists and that it's led with and grounded in law and ethics. It must be known that it is a safe and confidential conduit for reporting sexual harassment by state officials. Second, I would like to thank and applaud the courageous women who came forward and who also filed complaints with the State Ethics Commission. Several found me after the news went public, after the news about my complaint became public. And in this current culture, not one of them is in a place where they feel they can safely disclose their identities. This is significant. Thank you to Elizabeth Liz Jubin Fujiwara, who has served as my legal advisor. I appreciate your wise counsel and sharing of your deep experience in this field. I also want to acknowledge Speaker Emeritus Souki. I want to acknowledge him for his decades of public service in Hawaii. His long career in economic development and in the legislature have resulted in programs, policies, and laws that impact generations in Maui and throughout the state. Finally, and very importantly, I would like to express my deep appreciation to my family and to my friends for their support during this period. I know many of you wanted to speak out on my behalf, and I thank you for honoring my decision to allow this legal process to follow its course. The biggest thank you goes to my husband, Brad, for your unwavering support and love. We've both dedicated our careers to improving quality of life for others here in Hawaii, and you're a big reason why I'm able to do so in varied ways. I will now use this opportunity to share why I filed this complaint, touch on my experience after the complaint became public, and share my hopes for what each of us can do in Hawaii to change our collective future. Thank you for reading or for hearing this all the way in its entirety. As many know, I previously declined to comment on the details of my complaint out of respect for the State Ethics Commission's process. Now that's resolved, it's the right time for me to speak. There was inaccurate news coverage during this period because of a lack of information coming from me, and I can now speak with facts and reclaim my own experience. Let me start by giving you some background. When I was serving as the director of the State Department of Human Services, I was responsible for a budget of $3.3 billion, 2,000 positions, and programs vital to the lives of 25% of all residents in Hawaii and nearly 50% of all of our kids. As the head of a state agency, part of my role was to regularly advocate for our department's budget and policy priorities with legislators and ask for their support. While seeking support for my agency and the well-being of those it serves, my experience included legislators telling me things like, "You should be grateful for what I got you," and "I expect you to fill in the blank from you." The incident with Representative Souki involved abuse of this positional power to an extreme. Although there was a male colleague present, he made inappropriate comments specific to my appearance and an inappropriate request for physical contact that exceeded the traditional greetings we typically exchange in Hawaii. I do not think it's productive to share more of the details that led to my complaint. I will share, however, that the November 2015 incident left me angry. It was the first time in my professional career that I had experienced this type of inappropriate assertion of power where there is no path for recourse. The risk of retaliation against me, my department, and the administration for refusing to comply or for reporting the incident was real and could derail the good work happening. This work directly affects the lives of local keiki, kapuna, families, and individuals in our communities. I told others whom I trust about this incident and publicly remained silent. I also want to be clear about why I transitioned out of the executive branch, because this has been misrepresented, despite what I've consistently shared from the time I informed the governor through today. There were three main reasons. First, I left the Department of Human Services, DHS, in good hands with a clear path forward to work collaboratively for children and families. The department adopted a multi-generational approach. It's named Ohana Nui by our former foster youth, and this is to improve health, education, employment outcomes, and it did so in partnership with the Department of Health. Second, it was time for someone whose strengths include implementation to take DHS to the next level. And third, I believed I could play a role in accelerating progress for Hawaii from the outside. I waited until I was at least 1 year out of my position to decrease the chances that my complaint would become politicized. I quietly filed my complaint with the Hawaii State Ethics Commission after recognizing it as a viable, confidential entity for reporting sexual harassment in the state workplace, and with the hope that that resolution could open up a space for the community to focus on some real issues at hand. I did not file a lawsuit. I don't seek financial compensation or personal gain. I want to be clear that I respect those who file through the Hawaii Civil Rights Commission, the Equal Employment Opportunity Commission, or through the court system. I just chose a different route. It was only after a reporter received an anonymous tip that I decided to confirm my complaint. My decision was based on three things. One, I had already committed to disclose my identity. Two, I wanted other women to know they're not alone. And three, I did so for my own safety. My decision to file the complaint came from my deep love for Hawaii, our community, and our future. After my complaint became public, I was blown away by the support that came from hundreds of people both expected and unexpected. I am grateful for the overwhelming support and affirmation that stepping forward was the right thing to do for Hawaii and for other women. However, after reading some of the online comments to the published articles, I now know what it feels like to be shamed, judged. I now know what it feels like to be shamed, judged, and attacked by people who don't even know me. Although there are those who try to make me fear for my safety, the waves of support are so much greater, and they speak to the truth of our larger community. I want other women and the larger public to know this. I also want it to be known that although news coverage slowed after early February, the pain of abuse for many did not fade. I am so moved and saddened by what other women have shared over the last few weeks. They've shared about the abusive positional power they've experienced through their work at the state legislature. Some incidents are recent, while others are decades old. Regardless, the trauma and the visceral effects are vivid and carried, and the tears that come from reliving these experiences are real. It has taken a national and global groundswell of people to speak up, unite, and say me too, and time's up. Those who have been harassed can finally hear, I believe you, and they are no longer as quickly judged. Yet every single one of the local women with whom I've spoken, they shared that they were not and still not are they have shared that they are, were not and still not do not feel I'm sorry yet every single one of the local women with whom I've spoken share that they were not and still do not feel able to come forward publicly. How can we be okay with this in our islands? Like those who have come forward throughout the national Me Too movement, as well as the women in Hawaii who have filed on their own behalf, we are speaking about our past experiences, regardless of how long ago, because the trauma remains and the abuse and the cultures exist. We can all be better people, and we can all play roles in creating a different future for Hawaii and for our children growing into adults. There is me too, and there can also be us all. I was born and raised here and have dedicated my career to improving quality of life for others. And this includes the privately funded One Shared Future initiative I founded and lead to deepen and accelerate the public sector's work. Our shared values throughout the islands, our shared values of mutual respect, diversity, inclusion, and aloha, which is shared and taught by our host culture, are a big part of what makes Hawaii so special. These are our highest common numerators, which allow us to come together for change. We can move to a place where the future can be free of bullying, coercion, and harassment in local places of work and in our government. Many of us share the goals of coming together around our common values to create safe spaces for inclusive, substantive conversations about this uncomfortable topic, and for survivors of sexual harassment in the workplace to confidentially tell their stories. People and organizations are stepping forward to support this. Please be part of what's to come. Thank you. I would be glad to respond to any questions you have. And at the end of this, I do want to share a way for people to step forward.
Thank you. So, Rachael, what we got from Speaker Souki earlier today was that this is an incident or all incidents where he didn't know that he was doing anything wrong, and that this was something where he doesn't even remember what happened, but at the time it was just something more of a where nothing was done inappropriately. And I guess if you could somehow clarify, I don't mean for you to go into details of what happened or anything like that, but just say, well, this is clearly something that inappropriate for in any circumstance.
Thanks, Manolo. You know, I think I've been really clear that I'm not going to speak to the details of the incident. And also that I don't know if I've been as clear with others that this is really not about two individuals. This is not a Souki v. Wong type of incident. This is about Hawaii. This is about what we can be together. You know, for me, I think the findings show the clear inappropriateness, and I think, Dan, maybe you would speak to that. I can also speak to the fact that I'm in touch with several of the other women who have come forward in many different ways, and there are themes and experiences that we all share.
Can you speak to, on that note, do you mind speaking to the process of verifying whether or not these allegations that you received are true? I know you can't talk about the things that Michael Green brought up was sort of criticizing the process and the inability for him to be able to question the accusers. And so I was wondering if you could talk about what the Ethics Commission does to what they do in general to sort of reach the conclusion that they reached.
Sure. So in any investigation, we'll obviously interview relevant witnesses, if appropriate, and if they exist, we'll review relevant documents as well. Most of the Ethics Commission's cases are resolved through settlement agreements like this, but no one is ever forced to enter into a settlement agreement. Any individual who's the subject of an Ethics Commission investigation has the option to go forward with a full contested case hearing. And that's a full administrative process at which there is an opportunity to bring your own witnesses, to cross-examine witnesses, and to have all of that done in a full and open session. So in this case, we consulted and received complaints from a number of complainants. We did discuss the evidence that we had, and Mr. Souki was then willing and able to enter into a settlement agreement. I obviously can't speak to his state of mind right now, but that's the process that we have. There is, at the end, there's always a full opportunity to have a full open hearing if someone feels that the evidence is does not justify the charges.
Dan, is the Ethics Commission the way to go in terms of sexual harassment when, if you don't have standards of conduct like the House of Representatives has?
So there are always multiple avenues of relief for misconduct by state officials. So an individual who believes that she or he has been harassed by a state official can always file a complaint within the agency, if it's an employee of an agency. The person can file a complaint with the Hawaii Civil Rights Commission, with the EEOC, and with the Ethics Commission as well. In Ms. Wong's case, we had a situation where she wasn't the employee. It's not an employer-employee situation. The Ethics Commission's ethics code does cover this kind of behavior.
Yeah, I understand you fully investigated Ms. Wong's case. Did you fully investigate the other folks who came forward with complaints against
So her complaint triggered our investigation, and so we went forward and gathered evidence that we had both to support her claims, and in that process we received other allegations as well.
Did you follow up on those and investigate those, or was it just a receipt of allegation and then just brought the
speaker? No, we fully investigated.
Can you say whether there were witnesses and documents in any of those other cases to verify what the allegations were saying?
I'm not going to disclose any other details of what we had received from other complainants, other than to say that we did have other allegations of sexual harassment. We investigated those. We discussed those with the respondent.
Are those cases closed, though, or are you still pursuing them in some fashion?
So this matter fully resolves any claims of sexual harassment against Speaker Emeritus Joe Souki. So if there are other outstanding claims, the Ethics Commission would not take further action. As far as the commission is concerned, this is it. He's resigning. He's paying a fine to the general fund.
Dan, exactly how many other women came forward other than
this
one?
I'm not able to disclose that. I'm sorry.
So both of you, do you characterize this as a win-lose? Win-win? I mean, a lose-lose? I mean, what's the characterization? How do you feel about the resolution of this case?
Do you want to go first?
No, go ahead.
Thanks, Wayne. I've never thought of this in any binary terms. For me, this is really about what I was compelled to do, in the sense of that it came to a realization that I needed to say something or do something. I was fortunate to be in a position where I could. For a long time, I wasn't. And so when I made the decision to file the complaint, it was at that point I had let go of any type of animosity or anger. So I saw myself as holding this space. And especially when my complaint became public, it was about holding the space so others know they're not alone. So for me, it has nothing to do with win-lose or any combination of that. This is an opening where we hope that people can come forward and talk about what is sexual harassment, what does it feel like, what does it look like, what are all of our individual roles. So I just want to say again, this is not about individuals, it's actually about Hawaii, but the flip side of it is actually about what we as individuals can do. It's about each of our individual selves and our actions and our own awareness.
Is it a way to empower people to come
Yes.
out and talk?
empower people to come out and talk about everything. Men, women, children from all genders. I mean, really, this is something that we have not talked about in our community. You know, I think I've shared with some people I've spoken with the discomfort that I recognize that people feel speaking with me before this resolution came out, the discomfort. And so how do we address this discomfort, and how do we talk about what this means, and how do we engage with each other with aloha?
But, you know, the abuse of power is not just one single act. It's a series of actions that are reinforced through a person's career. You think that it should be stopped before it starts?
I think, you know, I spent last Thursday in D.C. I was very fortunate to be invited to the Aspen Institute's, gosh, I hope I say, it was a Women's History Month roundtable of leaders. It was part of their Women's and Children initiative. And I was surrounded with 29 other women who do global and national work related to women and children. And the topic was Me Too and Time's Up. It was people from the previous administration who worked for President Obama. It's people who lead NGOs locally in D.C. and across the world. And the consensus there was it has to be multi-pronged. It has to start early in the homes and in schools through education. It has to start with everyone stepping up together in the workplace, in different institutions, and throughout the community. So I think it was this recognition that it exists, the door has opened because of Me Too, and we all need to step up before that door closes again.
So you talked a little bit about your emotions when the initial incidents happened, anger, but then you also talked about even some shame and a sense of relief. Now here, can you just take us through your emotions throughout this whole process?
Sure, I can share that. And I'm sorry, I don't know.
I'm sorry, Paul, but Paul Drew is with KFC.
Oh, okay, thank you. Yes, it was immediately, as I walked out the door, anger. And it quickly shifted to, if this has happened to me, as an appointed official, the lead of a director, with a colleague sitting next to me during work hours with the doors open, my immediate concern was what has happened throughout the years for other women here and any place of power. You know, I think those of you guys all cover the political beat, and I don't know if you remember the first time you walked into the state capitol. It's an intimidating place. You can rush to get there. You're looking for the rooms. You're racing through the hallways, going around and around. It's set up so that you feel smaller than you came in. So I immediately thought of other people. And it took a good year and change for me to release that anger, to release what that assertion of power in inappropriate ways, how it affected me. And then at that point, there's no animosity. It really became a... I really recognized it came from love for our community, you know. And so there, like Wayne had asked, is this a win-win, lose, whatever? It's not. And so for me, it's a much larger issue, and it's a much larger motivation.
So, regarding this particular, because there is some resolution, is there a sense of relief, or you still have the sense of purpose that there's still so much more to do?
I think there's a sense of, well, for me, I can only speak to me, that I have a sense of relief that it's not ongoing. This is not something that went on for a long time, and I appreciate both the commission and your staff for moving this forward, but also to Speaker Emeritus Souki, you know, for his role in this coming to a resolution. I have been in touch with several of the other women, and I think the emotions range. I would say there is anger. There are a lot of negative emotions and things that are coming across my text. There's relief. But I think we all recognize that this is just one step of opening the door, that this is not the end of anything, this is the beginning.
But in order to see it through, you were willing to go through the contested case hearing and see it all
yes.
the way to the end?
Yes, yes, as were other, I mean, I can't, I'm assuming, right, if it was going to go through contested case, it would, I guess it's my case, yes, I was. Yeah. And I want to also share, and I think I've shared this with some people, is that if I was in a position where I was working three jobs, taking care of kids, caregiving for elders, you know, 2 hours of my day in transportation to commute to my jobs, I wouldn't have had the time or the resources to follow through. This requires a tremendous amount of effort. It's required a team of family, of friends, of colleagues to be, you know, confidants to be able to make this, for me to be present. So I want to emphasize there's many barriers to coming forward. You know, there's the shame, there's the judgment, there's the no make waves, but some of it's logistics. Some of it is, and a lot of it is the fear of the uncertainty of the future.
But not everybody has a brand either.
Right.
Like the Liberty Mutual.
Sorry, I didn't cut you off.
No, that's okay. And just to follow up on the question of logistics, you know, anyone who wants to file a complaint with the Ethics Commission, you can do so confidentially, you can do so anonymously, you can do it via a phone call, a fax, a letter, an email. And people should feel comfortable and confident that when you file a complaint with us that we will honor and respect that confidentiality. Our goal is to ensure the highest ethical standards for all of Hawaii state officials, and we do, by statute, have a confidential process for doing that.
Can I add on one more thing? I mean, not related to the commission, but you know, in my going through this process and for women coming forward to me, being part of these conversations, what I have learned, one of the real themes is that people want to tell their stories. They want to have they need to have an outlet to be able to tell their stories, to speak of their experiences, to be believed. And part of that is the healing process, but also to be able to start this process of the reconciliation and resolution. There's not always the option to come to the Hawaii State Ethics Commission if something didn't happen in a state environment. And so one of the things we hope that the media will do is to publicize the different routes that survivors and women can take, whether you're in the private workplace, or if you're in the public sector, wherever it is. And what some of us has done, we would like to hear from those who want to be part of moving this conversation forward. You know, there are actions that we can all take. And so we ask that people, if they're interested, and we welcome everybody. You know, I recognize that men have been shut out of some of these conversations. We welcome everybody emailing info@makehawaiisafe.org. So it's info@makehawaiisafe.org. And this will mark a beginning of us coming together to have these conversations in safe spaces.
There are a lot of private companies, though, that don't have written rules that you can really adjudicate. And so that should also be done.
I agree. That's the conversations we had in D.C. last week as well. And so it's, you know, where can we find these best practices? I'm not an expert in any of this.
Michael Green mentioned that, I'm sorry if I hope interrupted somebody, but Michael Green mentioned that he was afraid that this Ethics Commission decision and the complaint would lead to a chilling of the customary aloha kiss culture in Hawaii, and I was wondering if you have any response to that.
You know, I'm meeting many of you for the first time today. I've spoken with some of you in the past, and it was very conscious on my part to remain silent and to respect the process that was going through with the Ethics Commission as a legal process. I chose not to respond to media inquiries because things get played out in that way, and I think that's where some of that came from. It's not even relevant, bringing up the aloha kiss part of it. You know, there were only three of us in the room.
I think the other clear distinguishing factor in this case is that Speaker Emeritus Souki has admitted that the behavior in this case went beyond the traditional aloha
kiss.
Thank you. You know, I think, you know, it's that is an important part of local culture, and I don't think this case should do anything to change that. We're talking about conduct that goes beyond.
Thank you.
So in the commission's decision or commission settlement, he admits to going beyond the aloha kiss, but this morning he said he doesn't remember doing anything inappropriate, nothing inappropriate happened. He said he was hugging you because he felt sorry for you because you were leaving government, and that he kissed you and that it was not inappropriate. And so I was wondering if you could address that contradiction.
I mean, all I can say is that we have a signed settlement agreement from him with his signature on it admitting to certain conduct. So I can't control or speak to what he's saying right now, only to what he's agreed to in the settlement with the commission.
Again, true empowerment, though, should enable someone to say, hey, wait a minute, you're invading my personal space. I'm very uncomfortable. Don't do that. I mean, that should be an option also.
Can we interview you? Can we put you on film? I just want to respond, Anita, that just to go back to facts, that the incident took place in November 2016, and I'm sorry, 2015, November 2015, and I transitioned out at the end of August 2016. Thank you.
Rachael, you talked about your department and, you know, the responsibility you felt for your department, was there ever anything said to you that made you afraid to speak out then, you know, about your budget or the legislation, all that stuff? Was anything ever said to you?
Yes, and it was reinforced throughout the time that I was in that position. Thank you.
Can you talk a little bit, you mentioned about how it is a challenge for women to come forward and share their stories. So can you share with us how you came to that decision and why you felt it was strong enough and ready for it?
Sure. Again, I mean, it's the same process that I mentioned before. You know, I felt powerless in the moment. I checked around to see what paths and avenues existed, was told that there were none. And as time went on and I transitioned out, you know, I had time and space outside of this environment. And I just came to a realization that, you know, I needed to say something. And I'm guessing the Me Too movement was part of that. It was about the same time, and I was moved by what was happening across the continent and around the world. And I feel fortunate that I'm in a position where I can come forward and speak. And I am very aware, especially from the women I'm in touch with, and the many that are out there that I have no idea who they are, many are not in a position and struggle with this. I mean, throughout this process, women have struggled with whether or not they can come forward and stand next to me. And, you know, folks have said, I could be number two, but I wish there were three others standing next beside. And that's the reality of it. We live in such a small community that everybody is intertwined. And my coming out, my experiences have been, I've shared this, that, you know, conversation's quiet when I come in. People don't know how to interact with me. It's real. It's distinct. If I had a department right now that I was leading, I couldn't have said this because the risk of retribution was too big. I hope I answered your question.
And the other women who shared their experiences with you faced the same type of retribution, meaning from the speaker himself? They were in that position?
I don't know. Yeah, I can't speak to them. But, you know, when you think about the legislature, you know, we have the three branches of government, and all of us, whether we interact with any of the branches of government, there is the recognition, you know, we need to know that we're all dependent on the laws, the policies, the budgets that are passed through the legislative process.
I think we have time for about one or two more questions.
Now that this is resolved, what's next for it? Ms. Wong, sorry.
Oh. I didn't plan for this. I didn't plan to be here today as a face in front of all of you. But through this process, I've recognized that there is a need for us to come together as a community, and that's really the hope. That's what's become clear through this process. So I will be involved. I look forward to working with all of you and to hearing from other people in the community. And again, you know, we hope to hear from people if they email info@makehawaiisafe.org.
I was wondering whether what you think of Speaker Souki's apology this morning and whether it's meaningful to you, given that he's sort of saying this morning that he doesn't remember the incident actually occurring.
I didn't see it. Yeah, thank you.
All right.
One more process question. Mr. Green described a process in which if the commission had found fault with the speaker or found him to be, you know, run afoul of the law, what would happen after that?
So during a formal contested case process, again, each side would present evidence. It's a formal administrative hearing. At the conclusion of that, the commission would make findings of fact and conclusions of law, and then impose whatever penalty it thought was appropriate. The commission can impose penalties of up to $500 or up to $1,000 per occurrence. And then the commission can also refer the matter to other agencies. So. Usually what that means is that if the commission finds that a state employee has violated the ethics code, the commission can refer the matter to the employing agency and suggest or recommend disciplinary action from there.
So in this case, he suggested that what would happen is this would have been referred to the state house, where the house would have had the choice to, I guess, vote to expel. Does that sound right?
I think that someone from the house may be better able to speak to their exact process from there, but I think that sounds generally about right.
Since this case has come up, has your department gotten more reports? Are you investigating more cases?
If we had, I wouldn't be able to share that. Yeah. All right.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much.